captured the hearts and imagination of audiences around the world continues. Now, the most electrifying rematch in motion picture history, Rocky II, starring Sylvester Stallone, Talia Shire, Burt Young, Carl Weathers, and Burgess Meredith. Rocky II, rated PG, starts Friday, June 15th.
David, do you recall your days where you ventured into pugilism?
Oh yeah, I'm a fist fighter. I'm a bar hopper. I'm a punch kicker. I am a elbow thrower.
We documented that and had a whole series of films based on your rise through the sport of boxing. Yeah. We called it Munchie.
Yeah, Munchie. Well, yeah, that was the documentary based on my bare knuckle fights in dirty taverns and bars through the early 19th century.
It was all about your rise to the top and taking it all the way. So us talking about that was fitting that we're circling back to another franchise here that we're going to get into. But welcome back to another episode of ReconCinemation. I'm John Diner.
And I'm David Munchak.
And our usual co-host, Brent, is on vacation this week, is out of the studio lot. So we have a very, very special guest returning to us that we had this Shocktober. It's J. Blake Fichera from Scored to Death. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me. You guys are bringing me out of retirement
we're just gonna get you episode. Little by little. You're gonna just be on every week.
So good to have you here.
I appreciate it.
So we've had a fun month here. As the month of December, we went through our holiday season. We had Lethal Weapon, Better Off Dead, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, which was so much fun. But now we're coming back to it. Whenever I think of New Year's Eve or New Year's movies, as the New Year's rapidly approaching, I think about Rocky. Rocky being one of our top episodes, one of our original episodes. I realized it was time. We hadn't talked about it in a while. It was time to circle back. And who better than to bring on than you, Blake, who are a huge Rocky fan, right?
I am. The first Rocky movie is my favorite movie of all time. So I'm very excited to be here.
And we're glad to have you. We're going to dive deep into the second entry into the franchise. Let's also talk about the first one, too. Before we get there, why don't you tell us what's going on with you, Blake, and Scored to Death, and what's the latest on the book series and the podcast?
I'm the author of two books, Scored to Death, Conversations with Some of Horror's Greatest Composers, and Scored to Death 2, more conversations with Some of Horror's Greatest Composers. I do kind of a radio show on the Cinematic Sound Radio Network called Scored to Death Radio. And on that one, I get to just play cues and kind of act like a DJ. And I play horror movie cues, and hopefully I'll get around to playing non-horror movie cues at some point. I still am dabbling around with Scored to Death, the podcast. I don't do it all that often anymore, but I do have an episode that I've been editing since before the last time I saw you guys with David Shire, who, of course, composed the music for The Conversation, which we were just talking about off mic, as well as The Taken Pelham 1-2-3. And we even talked about Rocky because he was married to Talia Shire and he turned down during the first Rocky. But on Scored to Death, the podcast, I also have a very extensive and interesting interview with Bill Conti about working on the Rocky series, as well as many other films he's done. And so I'm still kind of plugging away at that stuff. The books are both out. And I've also just recently started doing some short interviews with composers for Fangoria's website. So that's been kind of fun, because usually when I interview composers, it's like a 3-hour endeavor. So getting to talk to somebody for 20 minutes and then getting to make a little article out of it has been fun. But that's about it. That's all that's going on in my end of the world. We did Rocky on Saturday Night Movie Sleepover several years ago as a New Year's special after the holidays, after the Christmas holidays. And I once talked about the entire Rocky series on the Wrong Reel podcast.
Ah, yes.
Many years ago. I don't remember if Creed had even come out yet, or maybe Creed had just come out when I did that episode.
What was Creed? 2015, somewhere around there, I think. 16, something like that.
Yeah, I don't remember. It was a long time ago. But yeah, so Rocky is one of my favorite subjects, so I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, how long was that podcast where you talked about the whole series? I mean, you could probably talk for 15 hours about that.
Yeah, James, who hosts that podcast, used to always know that when I was going to be on, it was a marathon. I think we talked about John Carpenter, for 3.5, almost 4 hours, and I was ready to keep. I was fine to keep going, but he tapped out on that one.
Oh, you made him tap out! Wow.
I think our Rocky one was over 2.5. I don't think it quite reached 3. He likes to go quickly, you know. Yeah. He's more about quantity than the details.
The Wrong Reel guys, I mean, they're up to like thousands of podcasts, right? I mean, they've got. I know they're over 1,000.
Yeah, well, James there for a while, he was doing them almost every day. Oh, so
wow.
he was at least doing out 3 or 4 a week or something like that. It was crazy.
We have a whole studio lot to run. We can't just spend all day podcasting, but
of course,
much as we'd love to. Mm-hmm.
So if you want to hear me blabber out about Rocky, you can also check out those shows after this one.
Nice, nice. Yeah, strangely, we were also just talking about how Rocky is our number 2 downloaded episode of all time. And It baffles me that one episode people keep coming back to for some reason recently. Like it wasn't doing particularly great for like 3 years. And then all of a sudden this year, it's like boom, 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 every day, download after download. So I no idea why, but I'm glad somebody likes it.
It's an anniversary, isn't it? It's gotta be, right? 35 maybe. 45, 45.
Yeah. 45, I think. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Well, so okay, we know you love Rocky, but Rocky II, what's your early memories of Rocky II, and what were your thoughts when you first saw it and compared to how you feel now?
I honestly don't remember. I don't remember ever seeing Rocky. Like, I don't remember the first time I saw Rocky II. I know Rocky was always a very, very big thing for me. 3 and 4 were on TV all the time as we grew up. I feel like the first one, 3 and 4 were on all the time when we grew up, and 2 really wasn't. And then sometime it switched, and then 1 wasn't on for a long time after we became more adult or into college, and then when we got out of college. But 3 and 4 were always still on. So for the longest time, 3 was my favorite because I used to watch that one all the time. It was on it seemed like it was on every weekend, even without cable, because I didn't have cable at my mom's house. And I knew that one so well that I knew exactly where all the commercials were going to come up. Well, every time there was a commercial, I was getting ready to go grab a soda or go to the bathroom. Like I knew exactly every commercial. Even now when I watch it, I anticipate a commercial break happening.
I remember that with like laser discs, when you'd have to flip the laser disc.
I had a friend of mine who was a bit older than us, and his big thing when he was growing up was the 8mm films, when you go and you buy, and he knows the 8-minute edits of Star Wars and Alien like by heart, like every shot. Wow. I don't remember. I mean, obviously you see the end of 2 every time you watch 3. Mm-hmm. I don't remember 2. I mean, I feel like I've always just known it. I mean, Rocky was huge for me. I grew up in Philadelphia until I was about 8 or 9. And my mom remarried and we moved to the Albany area in New York. And I feel that, you know, possibly Rocky was, a bit of a security blanket, you know, was you get to watch rock, you know, and I was homesick, and my brother and my dad still lived in Philadelphia, and my aunt, my, all my, my aunt and uncle and my, my grandmother, who we would visit a lot. And, cause my mom was a single mom, I spent a ton of time at my grandparents' house. They kind of co-raised me. So in a lot of ways, Rocky and then Rocky II by then, because they're so Philadelphia centric, were very much like homesick movies for me. And then even through high school, when we did Rocky on Saturday Night Movie sleepovers, I never thought about it, but Dion pointed out that when we were in college, I dressed like Rocky. I had the black leather coat and I never put two and two together that I was consciously going with a Rocky look, but I imagine that he probably did. He probably was right in some sense. But two, what I discovered, which I probably always known, anybody who's ever listened to me talk about Rocky, is that Rocky makes me cry like a baby every time. I'm, as now it's Pavlovian. I hear the track Going the Distance by Bill Conti, and I don't even need the movie anymore, and I can cry. When I was prepping for the Rung Reel episode, I went back and listened to Dion and I talking about the first Rocky as kind of preparation, because I already done all the research for that. And I literally started crying just listening to myself talk about
Rocky. Wow. Yeah. It's a trigger. Yeah.
And I remember standing outside of where Dion works one day, and I was doing more research for that, and I was listening to the film commentary, because I'll rip the commentary off of blue off the DVD or Blu-ray. I'll put it in MP3 and I'll just listen to it when I'm out and about, and hearing the movie in the background as John Avildsen's talking about it, I started crying in the middle of public. So one thing I discovered very clearly in watching it for preparation for tonight is that Rocky II is probably the movie, the only movie where I literally start crying within the first 3 minutes of the movie. I was like breathing funny, full on bawling in the middle of the fight, the beginning of Rocky II this time around.
Holy shit. But because you're, because it's the recap of the first movie.
Yeah. Cause the music hits and it's the recap, and Rocky has just become, I always, like I said, it always grew up as a big, really big part of my life, but at some point it stopped being played all the time. The first one. And then I don't know, about 13 years ago or so now, I was in my late 20s. I was 28, 29. I was going through like the worst point in my life. My girlfriend at the time and I were having a break, and I was out of a job. And Rocky came on Turner Classic Movies, and I caught it right as it was being introduced. And I was like, you know, I haven't watched the first Rocky since I was probably 17. You know, 10 years ago, 10, maybe more. And the difference between watching that movie when you're a teenager and you have the whole, your whole life ahead of you and the dreams of what you're going to do with your life, and watching it when you're 29, the age of Rocky, you haven't lived up to the potential you thought you were going to live up to. I was broke. I was worried about making rent that week. I couldn't get a job. My love life was not great. It had the most profound effect on me. And I now watch that movie at least once a year ever since then. And it just kind of changed my life in a lot of ways. And it made me realize how differently you perceive things, different ages you are. So now I definitely pay attention to movies that I watched in film school, you know, like the French New Wave movies and stuff, and how I feel so different about, say, The 400 Blows, which is like a very profound movie. But watching it as an adult about this little kid who, but instead of watching it when you're 18, it's like a totally different experience.
Oh, yeah.
And so for me, Rocky's even more important to me now than it was when I was growing up. And so it's just everything about that movie. And so especially the love story. So everything, when I watched Rocky II, and that music kicks in, Conti's music, like I said, it's Pavlovian to me. I start crying, and even just thinking about it right now, I could probably start tearing up. But then everything, and then the music, and then, you know, Adrian, yeah. And she comes in, and he's like, "Where's your hat?" And I love you. I love you. And it just like everything about it is just so beautiful. To me, that movie is lightning in a bottle. Everything from the casting. I mean, just think about how great Burt Young is.
Yeah.
And
all of Meredith. Everybody.
Yeah. It's just, it's so perfect. And the music, Conti's music in that movie is one of the most perfect examples of the marriage of music and cinema, in my, mm-hmm. my humble opinion. The only things that stand out as being a problem with that movie are the things that come from it just being low budget, you know, mm-hmm. a shaky Zoom or Dolly, you know, yeah. and, but other than that, that movie is about as perfect as it can be, in my humble opinion. And so the fact that it ends on that moment, and Stallone has talked about, you know, they kind of embrace and they lift up as they embrace, and then it freezes mm-hmm. on that last frame where they've lifted up in the frame, and it's a moment where if they never made another one, that exact moment was the highlight of Rocky's life. Nothing was ever going to be as good as that moment. He's got the girl, he went the distance, he proved it to himself. And then he's, you know, saddled with the task of, okay, so where does it go from
right. here? What's next? Yeah. Yeah.
You're like, okay, that's the highlight of his life. What's the next? What happens to these two kids?
Yeah.
And it's just two, like I said, I don't remember ever seeing it for the first time, but I feel like it's always just been there for me.
Yeah.
And, to answer your question, so I can let you guys talk for a minute. I don't think my view on it has changed much through the years, other than kind of what I was talking about with the first Rocky, mm-hmm. which is just that as I've gotten older, you know, I think I understand Rocky's plight a little bit more, and his feeling of responsibility,
yeah.
and, you know, having a wife. I mean, I don't have kids, but you know, those are the kinds of things that you think you understand, and maybe you do to a certain extent when you're a teenager or even in your early 20s. But
it hits you at a different level, you know.
Yeah, as you get older. I just appreciate that stuff in a different way, and maybe even more now than I did then. But I hear a lot of people talk about Rocky II and talk about how they really didn't like it when they were a kid, but they like it now.
Yep.
And it's probably a bit of a pacing thing. And John is pointing to himself at this very moment. So
we'll get to me.
Yeah. So, but I guess I can see that, you know, it's definitely, it takes a while to get going. It's definitely more of kind of I was going to say more of an adult story than Rocky. It's not, it's just a different kind of adult story about a different aspect of a relationship that I think is even harder for children or young people to kind of relate to.
Yeah. I have a specific reason and probably it's somewhat common to people in our age group who grew up with it. But before I go, David, what about you? When did you first see Rocky II? Is this a new viewing for you, or did you see it when you were a kid?
No, I'd seen it. I honestly, I couldn't tell you when I saw it, at what point, but, and you know, there was a certain point where I mixed up the movies where the early hospital scene where Apollo's in bed and he comes to him, like at a certain point, I didn't know that wasn't Rocky, right? You know, like because of in the way Rocky II starts with
they sort of blend, right?
Yeah,
I mean, that's the whole link to the previous movie in each one.
Exactly. So I couldn't tell you when I first saw it or anything like that. But, you know, it was Rocky was more, you know, that was the movie I would see more often, right? Like, and it was, yeah, like the same thing of like three and four were the bigger movies because they're big spectacles. Like two is this quiet sequel of, okay, the fairy tale's over. You know, the hero has gone through his journey. What happens next? And that's always sort of like, it's an interesting question. And it's always, you know, it is kind of like that boring thing. Like, you know, it's that thing of young and in love and I want to do this and I want to be with this person for the rest of my life. But then it's like, well, how do we pay the bills and how do we struggle? You know, like, yeah, you're committed, but this is that movie that answers those questions. Like Rocky had nothing, had nobody. And, you know, he got, and then at in the first movie, he got everything he wanted. Like, right. He succeeded. He reached the pinnacle of his life, but his life continues. Right. So he's married. And now he's facing a new challenge, but then also that love story continues. And that's the thing with one and two, is that love story is a bigger part of Rocky's life than as much as the fights, right? So yeah, I can see as a kid, like it's hard, it's really hard to latch onto. It's really hard to understand like the struggle of that, or the first year of marriage of between them. You know, you get it in concept, right? Because you typically, it's either you look at your own parents or you look at your friends' parents and relatives, all that. People get married, they live together, they struggle. You don't really get it, right? So that's like what you're saying. Like, it's like you like it more as an adult because you just understand it better.
You identify with it. Yeah.
Yeah. And as much as the love story of Rocky One is important, you as a child watching that, you can just stick to the heroics of what he's doing as becoming a hometown hero. And the second movie just like it amplifies each beat of the first movie. Like by the time he's training again, like the entire town of children, like there wasn't one adult following him in that. I was like, holy shit, there are 300 children following him up the stairs of the museum. Yeah. As it's really cool. Like it's it mirrors the first one a little bit, and I gotta give credit to it, doesn't fall into a lot of cliche that I couldn't remember where it was gonna go. I kind of, again, I'd seen it so few times, it wasn't a new viewing, but I really didn't remember it. But his dedication to Adrian, when she slips into the coma and everything, like I was waiting for some cliche, like macho thing. It never came. He was dedicated and is in love with her, and she was the only thing that mattered. And I just love that part of that movie.
I don't remember where I heard this or who said it, but it was something that I said to Bill Conti when I interviewed him, and he laughed at it. But I think it's so true where the whoever said it, and forgive me to them. I'm sorry to them for not remember who to give credit to, but they said, calling Rocky a boxing movie is like calling Gone with the Wind a Civil War picture, you know,
right.
It's so not about that. It really is this, both of them are really this love story more so than the rest of them. But, and I think that's definitely kind of the stuff that I started to connect with when I was, 29, 30, the love story, but also just this idea of, like I said before, like not living up to potential and, mm-hmm. and being down in the dumps and you start to, the first one is still one of those movies for me that when I watch it, I still notice new things about it. And I think about, Paulie and how they're all really Rocky and that they're all people in that movie that didn't get their chance. And now Rocky's getting his chance. And Paulie's jealous.
Yeah. And they're sort of living through him in a way.
Yeah. And Mickey's trying to take advantage of it because he wants his chance. And so it's a really fascinating one idea to make another one, but, to do something that wasn't done very often then, even if there was a sequel. I think maybe the first movie to ever do this, or the last movie to maybe do this before Rocky, and I could be wrong, might have been Bride of Frankenstein, to have a movie that picks up the second the first one kind of leaves off.
Yeah,
it's not something that happens often or still happens very often. And then to had to tell the story that we've just been talking about, like the continued love story, the troubles of that. It's just, I think it's, out of all of them, it's probably the most gutsy in terms of what they were trying to do with it. Cause the first one's like, okay, it's this story about the underdog, and it's a love story. And then the third one and the fourth one, like they've said, there are spectacles, and, you know, they have their own thing going on. And three, in a lot of ways, is the logical follow up. If you're going to follow this, someone who rises to the top and then has to gets knocked down a few pegs and then has to kind of fight back to be on top again. I can't imagine being asked to write a sequel to Rocky and what are you going to do?
Yeah.
Like, but when you watch it, but when I watch it now, it's like, yeah, this is the logical next step. Like, this is the perfect next continuation to that story.
And it's so, you know, as we've seen, especially now, all the reboots and the relaunching and the new sequels to older stories, logic is something that doesn't always accompany those projects. And this one, part of what's so great about it is that it's exactly in that world of Rocky. What would the next thing be? And this just nails it. It's sort of, in a way, like a perfect sequel, because it does follow that logic and it does treat those characters the same way. It's not, even though it is technically a new director, you know, yeah, it doesn't like shake anything up. So I came into the Rocky franchise, like three had, I think, just hit video or was out of the theaters, and four was coming in. And yeah, that's three was on video and four was in the theaters. So I was aware of Rocky one and two, but to me, they were like one blended movie. Like, I couldn't really distinguish exactly where they cut off. And I loved three and four. Like, you know, there's in three, you get three fights, really. You get the Thunderlips, you know, charity fight, and then the two with Clubber Lang. So in like a 90-minute movie, that is a lot of action. Whereas two, I think, has the least amount of boxing in it. Maybe we won't talk about five. Let's just leave that one aside. But, So, you know, two was always the slowest for me. When I went to summer camp, whenever we had a rainy day, we were like shuttled off to this this local college, Mercy College, and we would just be kind of like locked up in a couple of classrooms. And every year they had two movies that we could watch, Meatballs 2 or Rocky 2. And we had our pick.
Just the sequels.
It was only part two of things.
It's part of the rules of the camp.
But it was, you know, so it was, we were forced to watch those over and over. And as a kid, I was bored to tears with it because I was always comparing it to three.
Yeah.
And they're obviously, we'll get into it, like they're such different movies by that point. On top of that, my uncle was an AD and a production manager and worked on the reshoots of Rocky II, which I didn't know it. I didn't really, wasn't conscious of it at the time, but a few years after that I was, and he did, they did some of the reshoots of all the montage stuff. And then where he's running through the streets with the kids, like that was, my uncle was a part of that. And, you know, nothing really crazy happened on those shoots, but he's got pictures of him like, and Stallone playing like football at lunch, like the whole crew, like doing flag football and stuff. So, which they never let you sort of do that stuff with your actor director now. If he got hurt, like, forget about it.
Yeah.
I was in that camp. I didn't love two as a kid just because I thought it was so boring. But then as I got older and revisited them, I think in high school, like later years of high school, when that VHS box set came out, where, you know, that all kind of lined up.
Yeah, the red box. Yeah, with this picture on this spine. Yeah.
I got that and was like, I fell in love with two. That's when I sort of shifted from loving three and four to loving one and two so much more, because there's so much more meat on the bone and so much more emotions and real things to identify with that we've been talking about that. So two is definitely one of my favorites. It's the score, the opening score of, like, over the credit sequence, the ride to the hospital. That's, I mean, weirdly, like, that's my favorite track. I love
Redemption.
I would. So when I used to coach, we had a softball league here in Los Angeles that was all television shows. And I would build a little soundtrack to play as we were going to the game. And that was, that track was what started the.
Your way to the game, it's like.
Like, I mean, you could just play the whole Rocky soundtrack, but. I mixed it up. Yeah.
It's funny that you guys talk about how for both of you, you one and two are kind of the same, just one movie in your heads. You know, one of the things that I've been fascinated with for a long time, even before we started doing Saturday Night Movie Sleepovers, and it was something that Saturday Night Movie Sleepovers talked a lot about, were the extensions of the movies, novelizations. But one thing we also talked a lot about were photo plays, which are these little books where they take images from the movie and they essentially make comic books out of them. And they're really beautifully constructed montages of images. And they have the weirdest selection of movies. It was short-lived. They didn't make too many of them. They did maybe 13 episodes of the original Star Trek. They did Grease. They did the 1978 Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which I have.
I don't remember these at all.
Like a very odd collection. And they had Rocky II, but Rocky II was in photo play form, Rocky I and Rocky II. But it's, you know, in essence, the first third of the book is Rocky. And then the second two thirds of the book are Rocky II. So they don't just recap the fight. They kind of recap the entire first Rocky and then go into Rocky II. And I think, obviously, they knew a lot of people were going to kind of look at it that way, probably.
Yeah. I think especially, well, when did that come out?
Those are 70s things. I think that's why it's very strange. I have both Grease and in novelization form and in photoplay, just because I think it's so funny to have a musical and a totally literary form.
Right. Yeah.
It totally doesn't make sense at all. So it must have been all 70s, because they're all the movies that I can think of that they did them with are all 70s movies.
What? So the novelization did Stallone,
I guess 79, 80, something like that.
Yeah, probably 80 by the time it came out. What did Stallone write the novelization?
Supposedly Stallone wrote it. He's definitely credited as the only author on it.
Wow.
Are there differences? You know, a lot of times these are very different than the finished movie.
There are definitely differences. It's a very strange book, more so than most, in that it's almost entirely told in first person in the past tense by Rocky. So it's Rocky. It reads like Rocky telling you the story in Rocky vernacular.
Wow.
It does cut to the scenes where Rocky's not in it. It does cut to like a more traditional book format, you know, Apollo training, all the scenes with Apollo, Pauly and Adrian, but for the most part, I'd say 90% of the book is Rocky telling you the story, and it's Rocky's inner thoughts from his perspective. And unfortunately, Rocky's thoughts are not that profound.
He's not that deep of a thinker.
He's not that deep of a thinker. And it's very strange, because it'll even say things. I thought Adrian was the best wife ever. And then he says to Adrian, you're the best wife ever. Like, he thinks it and then he says it.
He is not a complicated person.
And there are funny bits that come out of that. There's a very funny exchange in his head thinking when Adrian wakes up and they have the little party in the hospital room. And Polly's there and Mickey's there and they're having champagne. In the book, Gazzo, Joe Spinell's character, is also there. And it's Gazzo that tells Rocky, I saw him. I saw the kid. He's a champ. He's got you know, he's got forearms the size of yours. And Rocky has this thought of Rocky drifts off and thinks about how weird that would be. He's like, I'm hoping that's not true. Because then he'd look like Popeye, and I know how, like, when he gets to school, kids will make fun of him for it.
Wow.
It's a very weird train of thought. It's weird stuff like that. In terms of differences, I wouldn't say there's anything so different. I mean, there are things, there's nothing that alters the story. There's
not
more
like
of the,
it's not like Halloween, that novelization.
Yeah, that has, you know, the whole backstory of Sam Hain and all that added in. No, but this one has, there's more publicity stuff. Rocky goes on Tom Snyder. He goes on the Mike Douglas show. There's a scene where he goes back to his high school and is given an honorary diploma. And through doing research for this, I found the audio of a news report from Philadelphia where the news, they actually shot that scene.
Oh my God.
Oh, wow.
And it was Stallone's high school, and Stallone's, and they went and shot it at Stallone's high school, and Stallone's high school gave him some kind of honor, but they shot that scene there. And they talk about, oh, Stallone returns to his high school to shoot the scene at Rocky's high school. There's no meatpacking scene stuff. There's more stuff. There's actually some kind of funny scenes between Pauly and Gazzo. They're kind of together more because Pauly's working for him now in the second movie. And there's,
oh, that's right. Yeah. Yep.
There's some funny things where he keeps on, Gazzo keeps on telling Pauly to do things and Pauly doesn't do them. And
that's a spinoff. If there ever was going to be a spinoff right there. That's a sitcom, an 80s sitcom right there.
But what it kind of takes the place of the, all the meatpacking stuff, and I think it works better in the movie, to be honest, is Gazzo wants Rocky to be a bouncer at a nightclub as for money. So instead of, because he can't get work. And so Pauly takes him to the club. So there's a scene in the nightclub where Pauly's kind of trying to get laid and Rocky's just standing there. And there's a girl who's very tall and he asks her how tall she is. And she's very, you know, offended by that. And it's just stuff like that. There's a lot of stuff of Rocky being, I wouldn't say homophobic, but afraid to be perceived as homosexual. He orders a drink at the bar because the guy next to him is having it. It's called like a Pink Lady, and he's very self-conscious about having just ordered a drink called the Pink Lady. Let me think. There's more foreshadowing that something's going to happen with Adrian and the pregnancy. She has like more issues. There's a scene, I think, that takes place in the kitchen where Rocky, she has a pain and Rocky's worried about her, but she's like, I'm okay. Some of the inner monologue stuff when he's training, he talks a bit about how he's kind of conditioned himself to be able to withstand pain. And it's something that he's always done, thinking that it'll come in handy sometime, like just pushing himself past the point of pain to, you know, in doing anything. Whether it's running and whatnot, just kind of getting into his head more. There's a scene where Adrian gives him the black and yellow trunks and robe before the fight as a gift.
Cool. Yeah.
He puts the baby to bed and he comes into their bedroom and she's laying in bed and he lays down and they kind of just look at each other for a while. And he talks about how nice that is, that she says, close your eyes. I have something for you. And she hands him a package. He says that I could feel the crinkle of the paper. And then he opens it up and it's the trunks. There's a good, would have been a good scene for the movie just before they go out to fight. Apollo comes to Rocky and wants to talk to him privately. And Mickey's like, no. And Rocky says, no, it's okay. I'll talk to him. And Apollo pretty much apologizes for the press stuff, you know, calling him a chicken and all that, but lets him know that he respects him, but he's gonna fight to win.
Yeah.
And Rocky tells him this kind of the same, that he's gonna fight to win also. There's a little bit of foreshadowing from the announcers who, when Apollo comes out, says Apollo looks like he's the best shape, but you know, hopefully he didn't over condition himself because that'll hurt him in the later rounds. Like maybe try too hard. So there's a little foreshadowing there. There's a funny exchange when Rocky comes in, where Rocky is telling you, the reader, that he's excited. And then he says to himself, why, he says to you, the audience, you know, why am I lying? I was nervous, you know, like, which wow. is interesting, an yeah. interesting way yeah. to approach that.
Well, there's lots going on in that book.
Yeah, yeah, but it doesn't really change too much of the, there's nothing that really alters the story. Sure. There's just,
it's just sort of filling it in more, right?
Yeah, yeah. And you can tell, like I said, the only thing that's kind of an exchange is that nightclub scene kind of takes place of the meatpacking. And I don't know why he did that, whether that's in the original script
yeah.
or not. But that's, I mean, those are really the big differences.
Well, and those novelizations, a lot of the time are based off of like one of the last drafts of the script, which is often before they actually start shooting, because they're putting those books out while they're shooting the movie a lot yeah. of times.
But why? So, but it's, since it's written by Stallone, though, it's
at lunch every day.
Supposedly, it is a little strange.
Yeah,
and it's a very weird read because, like I said, because it is first person, it's written in Rocky's speech, so it's. It's a rough read.
I've never read them, but that's like how the Game of Thrones books, right? Like the characters in the story yeah. are narrating very what's going
similar,
on.
Yeah.
So maybe, I mean,
he's a visionary.
Yeah. Wow. Look at that. So first person storytelling.
Well, let's kind of set the stage for what was, let's rewind back to 19, let's say 77, right after Rocky's come out. Obviously a massive hit, a hit at the awards, you know, shows as well. It was nominated for 10 Academy Awards. It won 3, but it, you know, won for Best Picture, Director, and Editing. But for Best Picture, it beat, my God, like, I know everyone talks about this all the time, but really amazing, amazing films. Network, Taxi Driver, All the President's Men, and Bound for Glory. I mean, each of those is a Best Picture. And Rocky beat all of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one's so, but Rocky was the clap, as much as it's a great movie, it's a little more of a crowd pleaser, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely, look, Rocky coming out in 1976, you look at, you know, the new Hollywood movement that was happening throughout the 70s. And this is like one of the very few sort of uplifting films that came out of that group. So many of the others were, you know, dark. It matched the mood in this country at the time, you know, post Nixon, post Vietnam, you know, very questionable sort of future and a lot of angry feelings. And you see that in so many films from that decade. It's part of why I love it so much. But
yeah,
but Rocky is like the exception, that it's, in a way, it feels like more of a traditional sort of studio movie, even though it's not, in that, you know, it's definitely, you know, a crowd pleaser.
Well, it has the grit of those movies,
right?
I mean, if it has the grime of Taxi Driver, it has the Joe Spinell of Taxi Driver. But it's a bright light in the middle of the darkness, you know movies. Yes, obviously we all love great movies that reflect the time, but ultimately cinema is also it's escapism. And mm-hmm. to have a movie that kind of captures the world that's being depicted in all those other movies, but does something in a way that is, one, uplifting, but two, is totally relatable to everybody. And I think that's why it just struck a chord, because mm-hmm. it was, people needed something to cheer for at that yeah. time, and Rocky was there for it.
Right. And you look at what happened a year later when Star Wars comes out.
Yeah.
You know, same thing, like something different takes them away, takes their minds out of reality. And look what you got.
Yeah. Rocky was the original Star Wars.
It was.
That's right.
It set the table for Star Wars. But it's, you know, again, back in this time period, there weren't franchises. In fact, it was rare that there was even sequels or a series of films. But I mean, you had Godfather 2, obviously one of the biggest. Yeah. They were out there, but, you know, I don't think there was ever really a thought process that this was going to be an ongoing franchise throughout the decades. It was just one movie. And then with the success of that movie, pretty quickly, they greenlit Rocky II. Right? Wasn't that, I'm pretty sure the...
I would imagine so. But yeah, I mean, horror did it in the, you know, with the Universal Pictures and then Hammer. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was definitely not common practice to have to even imagine that a series would build from one success. You said you had Godfather 2, but I can't really think of too many other sequels from that time. I mean, there are...
You have the Sting too.
Yeah. And you have... But you had the thematic... sequels like the Leone Westerns, mm-hmm. or even the Dario Argento. Well, I guess Inferno doesn't come out till 80 in terms of being a kind of sequel to Suspiria. But yeah, it was not common practice for them. I was going to say, in a way, Rocky kind of sets the stage for the movie franchise 80s too.
Yeah, because Rocky starts it. I guess Jaws is sort of a part of it, right? And then Star Wars, and then Indiana Jones, and then it's happening.
Yeah,
then
and you get the slasher movies,
right?
You have Halloween's and Friday the 13th, and
yeah, Texas Chainsaws.
Well, like you have the Dirty Harry movies, right? It's not really
true.
Exactly.
True. Yeah.
Throughout the 70s, right?
They're probably by this point were at least two of the Dirty Harry movies were out, if not three.
Yeah, I'm trying to think when the third one came out. But yeah, you probably definitely had Magnum Force by then.
Yeah.
But that's a different kind of thing, you know, right?
Yeah, it's a good pull though, because that's something I didn't even think about. But it is. I mean, that's a direct sequel with the same hero.
Yeah. So I think it's just sort of occurring to studio executives at this time that, we can do another one. We can do more with this, and then it would morph into doing three sets of trilogies and prequel trilogies and sequel, you know, quadrilogies. And
I love a quadrilogy. I love a good.
I just want to throw that word out there.
I always love a good quadrilogy.
What's Rocky up to now?
Oh, we continue to find out what Rocky.
We've answered that question 8 times.
Yeah, something like that.
With Rocky Balboa and the two Creed movies.
That's
8 Rocky movies.
Yeah.
What?
And you know what? Why not? Rocky V, I care so much every time.
They're all really good, right? More or less, you know. Yeah.
Even Rocky V has its charm.
Rocky V is for kids, and then it's fun.
Five,
just enjoy it.
Rocky Balboa feels like a redo of 5. Like, here's what I kind of wanted to do with 5, and I'm doing it right this time.
Yeah, I mean, you can also very much... Rocky Balboa feels like could have been a very good sequel to the first one or the second one.
Yeah. There's like paths. You know, we talked about it. Dave and I talked about it on some of our other episode, like the Halloween franchise, that you could go off and like, it's like a tree. You can go off in a number of different directions with the sequels, what your continuity is, but you could definitely do 1 and Rocky Balboa, or 1 and 2 and Rocky Balboa, and still have it be a like completely believable series.
Yeah.
But John G. Avildsen, who directed the first film, won an Oscar for it, opts not to come back for the sequel. I don't know. Behind the scenes, I don't know how much Stallone really wanted him to come back. I have a feeling by this point, Stallone really just wanted to take the reins all the way himself. So maybe it worked out that Avildsen, I think, was lined up to direct Saturday Night Fever.
And yeah, that was sort of heard.
Yeah. And then ends up not directing that movie and does 2 other movies, I think, that are I've never even heard of. But so I don't know how he felt about this, but
I just watched completely unrelated before you asked me to do this. I had just watched The Power of One.
Oh, yeah.
For the first time since the 90s. Which is an John Avildsen boxing movie.
Yeah.
And then, young Brad Dourif.
Yeah. And then, you know, he eventually does the Karate Kid films, which have so many parallels to...
Steven Dourif, I'm sorry. Not
Brad. Yeah. The Karate Kid films have so many parallels to Rocky. Like,
yeah, totally.
On a formula level, they're very they're very close, the first ones especially.
Yeah, so. And Conti does the music too, yeah. So it's gorgeous.
Like Avildsen, he knew what worked and went back to it. So after a few missteps, like Neighbors, do you ever see that one?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a tough one. An interesting film.
That was one when I talked to Bill Conti. I don't even remember how it came up. I interviewed him a couple, now it's been 2 years ago, so I don't remember every detail. But he says, you know, that's a movie that he scored and he doesn't even remember doing it. Like he doesn't remember the movie. He doesn't remember writing the score.
I think everybody took that one. And it's the simple switch of switching Aykroyd and Belushi just through that whole thing for a loop. Anyway, we're digressing here, but so Stallone ends up, you know, the producers, Chartoff and Winkler have to really push the studio to allow, which was, I believe, MGM UA, who to allow Stallone to direct it. He had done Paradise Alley in 77, maybe, I think.
I read this in kind of the notes that you sent. I've also read things that it was very disheartening. Like I read that, you know, like Paradise Alley came out while he was making Rocky too, according to him.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know when they started shooting it, because he talks about how it was very discouraging to have this movie that had just come out and been a flop while he was in the middle of making his next movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how discouraging that was, and how everybody, it kind of put the pressure on him and Rocky too. I could see both of what points that you're making in terms of Stallone probably didn't want Avildsen to come back, because obviously he had his sights on directing. But I can also see why he is a logical choice to pick up the mantle, because he was so involved in the first, not just writing it, but he choreographed the fight scenes. He was doing rewrites on the scripts throughout the whole movie to make up for the fact that they couldn't get extras for the ice rink scene. You know, he was constantly changing the script to accommodate the budget problems they were having. And so it's almost as if, when you hear about how involved he was, it was almost as if he co-directed the first one anyway.
Sure. I mean, he may as well have, you know, obviously he's not credited, and none of us having been there, hard to tell like who is really doing what, but yeah, absolutely. The logical choice is to just, he's already holding the reins anyway, just let him have it. I don't know if anyone has ever embodied their film as much as Stallone embodies Rocky. So why not? You know, he's pretty much doing everything else. So
when you watch like the special features for Rocky Balboa and their shooting in the Italian market in South Philadelphia, and people are just like, "Hey, Rock." And he's like, "Hey, how are you?" he walks around Philadelphia and people just call him Rocky, and he just answers to it. It's not even weird. Like he is Rocky to people, especially when he's dressed up like that and he's in Philadelphia. So yeah, I mean, nobody has kind of, you're right, has embodied a character the way he has just kind of like embodied that character for himself. Yeah.
And then eventually Rambo, but Rambo is so different. You know, Rambo does not have the emotional content that the Rocky franchise does. The first one does. When you get to three, especially, like, it's a whole different ball game. But
this is how many times have we had Stallone on our show now? I mean, he is the number one actor focused, right, John? Like we've covered Rocky, we've covered Demolition Man,
Copland, Cliffhanger. But let me say this. Technically, if you want the answer to that, the person who's made the most appearances on our show would be Mr. Tom Atkins.
Yeah, well, sure. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
You want the technical answer.
It's fair enough. I mean, we are a Tom Atkins podcast.
Yeah.
You know, Sly, and like for what Sly does, I mean, you got to really respect the fact that he, you know, coming from Rocky, and then he just does whatever he wants, right? We didn't cover it, but I always point to Oscar of like, he didn't direct it, he didn't write it, he's just a character in this silly door slamming farce that should be a stage play, and it's, I just find it so delightful. But like of all the, you know, the different things that he's done over the years, like, you know, he'll stick to his, you know, the Rocky is like, is such a, there's such heart to that character. Mm-hmm. And then of course it becomes a franchise, and then Rambo, the same thing, becomes a franchise. But you know, he tells so many different stories, and like, you know, he, and even in, when he does Stop or My Mom Will Shoot, because he just sort of like fell for the idea, like in the 90s, you got to do a zany action comedy, because like now you're out of it. I think Stallone is the surprising hero of our podcast, because we keep doing movies about him.
And there's plenty more. There's so many more to do. We haven't touched Rambo yet.
Yeah, Rambo's not even a thing yet. There's so many. For whatever it is, like the fact that he had to sort of keep up with Schwarzenegger, and when Schwarzenegger became such a, you know, they were in tight competition in mm-hmm. terms of like household names, and just sort of like embodying like just the super, super strong, super heroic kind of guy in the 80s and 90s. And I don't know. I think it's interesting his choice of projects over the years. I think I like them as choices more so than Schwarzenegger. Schwarzenegger obviously made amazing choices that like made him probably even more even wealthier than Stallone on some level, or I mean, who knows, but you know, Schwarzenegger became like more of a family friendly household name mm-hmm. earlier. But you know, you got it. There's something about what Sly does and picks.
He stayed relevant. Like he stayed, you know, I mean, he's come in and out, but he's found a way to sort of come back, even with the Expendables, like, mm-hmm. you know, taking a spin on his own movies and just getting all those old action stars together. I mean, all the way to like Harrison Ford, you know, like, I mean, it's incredible that he's been able to do it and then rework Rocky.
Yeah. Right. Well, he's a smart guy. He always has been. Yeah. And I think those choices come out of the fact that I remember doing an episode of Saturday Night Movie Sleepovers, and Dion is very much more actor oriented than I am. Mm-hmm. For the people that don't listen to Saturday Night Movie Sleepovers, he's the co-host of that show. And I said to him, you know, I can't think of any actors that I really gravitate towards in the same way. I'm more of a filmmaker guy. I'm into filmmakers. He's like, well, you know, Bruce Campbell. And I said, oh yeah, that's true, Bruce Campbell. And he said Stallone. And I said, that's true, but a lot of what I like about Stallone is the fact that he directs and the fact that he writes. And even on a lot of those movies that you even just mentioned, he has writing credit on them. Mm-hmm. And you know, First Blood is a perfect example of the fact that he allegedly took that script and said, you know, he's just a robot. He's a killer robot.
Yeah.
And he made Rambo relatable, and you could empathize with that character. And I feel like that's Stallone's greatest strength, is his heart. And it, mm-hmm. and you see it in Rocky, and everything that's totally, all the movies that work for Stallone the best are the movies where you can see that, you know, he's all heart. Rocky's all heart. Yeah. So is Stallone. I've come to, you know, a movie that everybody makes fun of, but a movie that I absolutely love is Over the Top. Mm-hmm. And it's because it is so heartfelt.
That montage, the him and the son, the, you know, working out and training around the truck. Love it.
Yeah.
I remember there was one of the executives for James Wan's company, Atomic Monster, told me or messaged. Oh, he responded to me promoting that on a Canon Films group on Facebook or something, and saying, "Hey, you know, we covered it." And he responded, "It's the single best podcast episode about Canon Films ever." it was our Over the Top episode.
Yeah.
And you know what? I'm very proud, not of that he said it, but I was very proud of our Over the Top episode because I think it's a movie that doesn't get its due. Totally deserves it.
I hadn't watched it. I mean, I saw it when it first came out, but then I didn't rewatch it again until I heard your show. And I was like, oh yeah, I got to get Over the Top back in there.
That's amazing. I want to cover that. I hope we can cover that in the next couple of years.
Robert Loggia. Great.
Oh yeah.
Loggia is the father-in-law or the father? Yeah. Is he Sly's father?
He's a father-in-law.
Father-in-law.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. He's got to teach his son how to go over the top.
But he's not in Rocky II, unfortunately, though.
No,
Robert Loggia.
But I think over the top single-handedly, I remember in grade school, there was lots of arm wrestling matches.
Oh my God. Popular then.
But I don't know if the movie, I mean, I think that might be a vestige of just like, this is one thing you do as kids. Like you to prove, I don't think there's arm wrestling matches going on now.
Was completely because of over the top.
I think it's part of it. Yeah. Like, you can't fight each other. You know, you're not supposed to fight each other or wrestle, but like, okay.
Well, the fact that as a kid, you could buy an over the top arm wrestling table.
Yeah.
No. Yeah.
So
yeah.
That you could arm wrestle your friends in proper over the top,
officially licensed over the top arm wrestling tape. Anyway. I smell a next year's Christmas present for David.
You know what I like.
What's going on in Rocky II? Watching it as an adult and part of what's so fascinating about it is the parallels of what's happening with Stallone in his life and Rocky in his life, that, you know, you've got Rocky has the success of that fight and the personal success of it and at least a short-term financial success of it and a skyrocketing in popularity. Same thing with Stallone, who goes from, an actor that nobody knew to a megastar who's, holding an Academy Award, and then where do you go from there? What do you do next? He does a movie called Fist, which I have actually never seen and don't know that much about, but I don't think it was a major success. And
no, it wasn't.
Right. Yeah. And then you've got Paradise Alley, which was not a success. And he's got an appearance on The Muppet Show, which I think was a success because I've seen that clip a zillion times.
Awesome.
But, you know, I think it was very questionable about like, okay, is this a one hit wonder or how is he going to sustain this momentum? And taking that and making that Rocky story makes so much sense, like we've said, and works so well because the entire movie is just about that journey and him wanting to step away and start a family. But he's got to support that family. He's also injured from the fight that he's, was it his left eye, right? That's his eye. He's got like an eye injury.
Yeah. I think it's his right eye.
Right eye.
Yeah.
He's impaired. He's trying the do commercials and publicity stuff and he's terrible at it.
Yeah.
So he realizes very quickly, like this money I got and this success that I have, it's going to run out real fast if I don't figure out what to do.
Also, it's also just a great story about the business of show, whether it be sports or this, because even, he gets paid $150,000 to fight Apollo in the first. And then Joe Spinell says, well, how much did you bring home? And he said, $37,000.
Yeah. Right. Sounds great, but at the end of the day.
he's never had money. He doesn't know what to do with it. And he just frivolously, kind of throws it all away. And all of a sudden
it's in 70s dollars though. So
yeah, that's true.
Yeah. 37 and 70.
Yeah. But he buys the car. He buys, all the like expensive clothes. He gets a real, the house, right.
The dog.
Yeah.
Dog and dog collar.
Yeah. Butkus, right.
He buys him Buckus a dog collar, and he buys himself a dog collar.
what's he going to do after that? So that's the big question, and wrestling with that, and at the same time, Carl Weathers' performance as Apollo is really fantastic in this film. We spend a little bit more time with him and see his side of it. That this is just. He didn't lose the title, but he definitely did. He, Apollo, did not win.
Yeah. Well, he's, in my opinion, he's another, I was talking about earlier how the first movie is just lightning in a bottle and everybody's perfect. It's yeah. The script is perfect. Everybody in it's perfect. And Carl Weathers is perfect in the first one. He's yeah. So good. And it's interesting because he said something to the effect of he tried very hard. He knew Apollo was the antagonist, but he tried very hard not to make him a villain.
Yeah, exactly. And he definitely did that.
Yeah. And he's totally successful at it. And he's so good. He's so good in both of them. And yeah, his arc in the second one is, it's not so much of an arc, but his story in the second one is so great. And Tony Burton, I love the scene where Tony Burton's like, we don't need this guy in our life. And his speech was, I saw this man, I saw you beat this man worse than I've ever seen anybody ever get beaten. And he just kept on coming at you.
Yeah.
And I love Tony Burton so much. And,
I love it. Yeah.
And that scene is so great.
I do see Apollo as a little more of a villain in this one though.
In this one, but
like, you know, he's tough to, it's tough to have a like respect for him. You know, I get it in the first one, but like this one's tough. He's very ego driven. You know, it's very satisfying what, you know, whatever deficiency of like not actually beating Rocky, winning by that split decision. It's really one round, you know, it's like, I think that's a split decision. So then I get it. Like he's not a villain, but it is like,
He's using like villainous tactics sort of,
and he goads him into that, and like it's very macho like bullshit of like calling him a chicken and that's what gets Mickey riled up. we gotta take this asshole down. He called you a chicken in the newspaper.
Yeah, that was a big time. Calling that, somebody out with that.
That shit worked, man. Marty McFly too. You know, you don't call him yellow.
I totally agree with you.
It's a cheap way to get them to get together. You know.
Yeah. Well, it's also there's something about there's a TV appearance that he does is what gets Mickey all fired up. Not really the newspaper thing.
Well, you're right. But it's the same yeah. idea. Like it's not that. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, totally. Bad. I mean, yeah, it's definitely ego driven, but yeah. I don't know. I think in a way it's relatable in that it's something we can relate to that we're probably not proud of that we can relate to the way he feels. I mean, in a way it kind of relate to what Rocky says, you know, I would never ask you to stop being a woman. So don't ask me to stop being a man, which is an absurd line because, you know, that has nothing to do with being a fighter. But I guess for these guys, it does mean that. And so I can see, I can just understand whether I agree with it or not. I can understand Apollo's feelings towards it.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's very of the time, very of the, of, you know, men's values, men, you know, especially in something of the sport of boxing, you know.
Yeah,
I mean, of all the things to compare your, you know, your manhood or whatever to
masculinity,
boxing is a great frame that like you're gonna see that extremity.
But it's also, you know, he's spent his whole life to become the champ.
Yeah,
and to now be discredited. I mean, there's more of an input. There's more at stake than just, I think, personal pride in a way that people don't believe that people think that he threw the fight.
Right.
You know,
not that the movie needed it, but it would have been something of like him sort of regretting he picked him out of a phone book, essentially, in the first movie. Like Apollo, where Apollo ends up after the first movie is entirely his own fault, right?
Yeah.
So,
oh yeah,
there's nothing about that of his own. Oh shit, I did this to myself.
That's yeah,
and sort of, so he makes Rocky a target. So there's that's the missing piece, I think, of that of his arc. Or
yeah, you know, I always love that. That's one of the things that's another one of those perfect things in the first one is like the whole reason why this fight even happens is because Rocky's nickname is the Italian Stallion. He sees that and he said, that's it. Apollo Creed versus the Italian Stallion. It's a goddamn monster movie.
yeah You can't market something. You can make it up better. You know, he just found the perfect thing. So
it's fate.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, like, you know, I don't see Apollo as the villain, but it's I'm rooting for Rocky the whole way. I mean, it's Rocky's movie, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But obviously.
Yeah.
But and that's something with this is like, look, Talia Shire, wonderful. And the way it's her, you know, Adrian's written, you know, when she accepts his proposal and gets married to him, why is she still so completely frightened at all moments? It's not Talia's performance particularly, but like, she's not smiling. She's not in love. Like, she doesn't seem like she's in love with him. You know what I mean? And I get it. She's introverted. Like, this is her character. She would not be this person, right? But he's forcing her out of that. But it's hard to find the breakthrough until, even her waking from the coma and saying, when, like, okay, like, how did that come about? How did she come out of the coma after everything she was like sort of standing against Rocky for, you know, and then like, do it, risk everything, kill yourself, like, face this villain, face this guy. So there's like, there's sprinkles of like, sort of, it's getting a little silly here to me.
Yeah.
In this one, that it satisfies Rocky's needs and nobody else's, you know?
Yeah. I mean, in terms of her being, you know, such a downer through the whole first half of the movie, I think she's just waiting for the other shoe to drop. She sees mm-hmm. that he's spending the money, but she also is like, you should get yourself one, because she's also never had any money either. I think she says, look, the bank says we can get a loan at this. You know, I think she's just really scared. Yeah. Through all of it. And it's about the finances. It's about the change in her life, obviously, because it was just like 3 weeks ago she was living with her brother who treated her like shit.
Yeah, like beat the shit out of her.
You know, and then obviously that she wakes up and she tells him to win. It's a very convenient story device. I mean, it could have been more earned, obviously. You know, she obviously doesn't listen to Polly when Polly goes and says, like, look, if you don't get behind him, he's going to get killed. Like, you're hurting him. You're not helping him. Yeah. And maybe in her, maybe in a coma, she thought that, she thought about that a lot.
well, that could be because there was nothing Rocky couldn't deny who he is. Right. So he said, I'm sorry. And he went out the front door. Right. So Rocky can't be changed. So it's either she either has to be as obstinate as he is, or she has to allow him to be. So maybe that's where it comes from, you know, like she's just happy to be alive. And she, you know, Rocky's going to be, if he needs
Rocky,
to be, the
Rocky's going to be Rocky.
Yeah. Right. So it
can't
is
stop
sort
that.
Of, yeah. So, I mean, that does make sense a lot.
But it is, I mean, you're right. It totally is convenient, and why it works in that scene is because Bill Conti's music cue comes in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Going the distance kicks in, and then we go right into a montage, and
now it's on.
We've accepted it. Okay, let's do it now.
But as I was rewatching this, I honestly couldn't remember if she wakes up before or after the fight. So I was like, is he going to get her out of a coma by beating the shit out of Apollo Creed? Is that how he saves her life? But again, those, like, I don't know, 20 minutes we spend with her in the hospital and him by the bedside and all that. I mean, boy, does that just make the movie for me in terms of defining Rocky, of all the choices he's making, all the things he's trying to do, all of that. And no matter what, it all comes down to her, even though it's like, he's kind of a force, you know, he's a force of nature with her, right? He's sort of always just sort of pulling her toward what he wants the whole time, you know? And it's like, I almost don't even understand why he loves her so much, in a sense, like, what's so great about their like interpersonal relationship, but whatever that is, it's that, you know, that's working for them. But I mean, he dedicates himself to her and dedicates himself hard. And then as soon as it's time to, he gets the go ahead. Okay. Now he gets his montage.
Well,
and you know it too. Like, you know, at that point, when that montage starts, at least I remember just thinking, like, he's got to win. Like, there's no way he's not winning.
He has
this fight
to win this shit, right?
Like, I know how this is going to end, and I want to see every second of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But to talk about the extended sequence of Adrian in a coma, I mean, it really is. I mean, it's the kind of the backbone of the whole movie because the first one is so much about the development of their love story, that, and she really is the prize at the end. Like, she is what he wins at the end of the first one. But I also think that what I love about that sequence is it shows that, like, Mickey now cares for him too.
Mm-hmm. They're like a family. Like, the whole, all of them have sort of come together as a family.
Yeah. And he's like, well, if you want to sit here, then I'll sit here. I'll sit here with you. And so you see Mickey sitting, sleeping, falling asleep in a chair. And it's one of the things that when we did Karate Kid on Saturday Night Sleepovers, and why I loved that movie so much is so much that relationship between Miyagi and Daniel. And I realized then when we did that episode that, you know, as I kind of insinuated at the beginning of this discussion, that my grandparents kind of helped me raise me when I was little. So I was very close to my grandfather. And you really, you know, you do, obviously there's a relationship in the first movie, but Mickey, you know, I love the relationship, and I love how my favorite scene of that whole movie is when Mickey goes over to visit Rocky and tells him, you need a manager. But you see that relationship develop in this one. Mm-hmm. And you see that kind of surrogate father mm-hmm. and son relationship start to blossom. That becomes much bigger in 3, obviously. But yeah, that's those scenes are some of the best scenes in the whole movie. It's just him trying to read, you know, William S. Burroughs books to her. She's gonna go in the novelization. One of the other big thing that I didn't mention before is he's leaning on the bed and he falls asleep, and he has a dream where he flies out the window and he's flying over Philadelphia, and it's because he's looking for her, like, wherever I am, he feels like he's like dead, or he's in some, and he's looking for her. And then what wakes him out of it is that she starts to move. It's when she wakes up, and she wakes up and he thinks he's still dreaming, that she's mm-hmm. opened her eyes and stuff.
Oh wow.
Which is, it's a little cheesy in the book, but it's also kind of a nice touch.
If they shot it, it would have been great if they shot it like Superman.
His like arm,
boy,
just one
the boy
arm.
Boy who could fly.
The other arm behind his back, and he's just like, flying. And Philadelphia, how grimy is that city, by the way? Holy shit. Nothing about Philadelphia is pleasant until you get to the art museum at the end.
It's an old city. It's an old city.
Is Sly is from there? Is that right?
I don't know if he was born there, but so best of my knowledge, he spent at least a period of his youth growing up there.
Gotcha. And then you were there until you were 9, and then I went to school to LaSalle in the late 90s, early 2000s. Still have good friends there who in Philly. But I'll never go back there.
That's it. You drew a line in the sand.
That's all right. I know I belong. I the further west I go, the better off I am. So the East Coast has a chip on its shoulder. I cannot hang with. But God bless all the people that continue to keep those wonderful cities and towns thriving. Yeah, and I think there is something lovely about, you know, Mick could have just gone back to the gym, you know, just gone back waiting for Rocky to come back, but he stuck with him, you know, that father-son relationship surrogate thing really works. There's so many parts about Rocky too that just it's really a logical extension of that first movie, and I think all the notes are just really hit really well. It's kind of a magical thing, right? I mean, it's not a better movie, I guess, of the first one, but it's a different movie, right?
It's next level. It's not, I mean, obviously the first one is establishing it, and it's got I don't know if I want to say the stronger story to tell. Like, this is a great, what it is, it's a great chapter two to an amazing first story. So But all these characters, I mean, from, you know, Apollo to Pauly to just everybody is like sort of along this ride with him. And they're all of their characters are evolving and they can continue to evolve through the franchise. I mean, with Pauly, like we kind of move very quickly away from the fact that he was probably beaten up, you know, Adrian and was abusive to her that and really was not a good guy in that first one. No, until that moment, you know, where he lifts the ropes for her and she comes in the ring. Like, to me, that's a moment that gets me every time I see it. You know, this guy who almost like seems like he hates his sister and then does something just so beautiful for her and so subtle. So just a small thing, but it means so much.
I don't want to get too far into the first one, but there's so much. Through my journey of the last, you know, 10-15 years has been my love of Burt Young as Pauly and of that character. Mm-hmm. He's really kind of underutilized in two. But yes, I mean, obviously we gloss over the obvious abuse, but he's so beautifully portrayed in the first one, and it's part of what I was saying before, which is, you know, they're all Rocky but he never does get his chance. And just the mise-en-scene of having,
oh, you brought that term out. Look out.
Yeah, you know, we see a picture of him in like a naval outfit, mm-hmm. in the first one, and so you know that there is like this other life, and and things just didn't work out for whatever reason for him. And he takes it out on her and he's like, and that's why that, I mean, the scene where he goes crazy and he's banging, he's hitting things with the bat and he's yelling and she's like, I don't owe you anything. And it's just, cause that is the moment that that's her pivot. Mm-hmm. And then she goes and she said, how would you want a roommate? And he's like, yeah. But you know, he's so sad. He's so lonely and he's so pitiful. And then that scene, it kind of all boils to a head, and not that it justifies any abuse that he may have both emotionally or possibly physically given to her. You at least understand that you at least understand why, mm-hmm. he is the way he is.
Yeah.
And in that first movie, the fact that the first time we see him, he's trying to fix his hair in a broken mirror in the first movie is just so perfect. Like, even the way Pauly looks, it's important to him. You know, his appearance is important to him. And the fact that at the end he brings a prostitute to the fight of the first one. He's so, more than even Stallone embodying Rocky, I like, when I look at Burt Young, he just, you can only imagine his performance in that first movie, that they hired Pauly to be himself in this movie. they just captured documentary style this guy. He's good in that movie.
He's kind of always Pauly too. I mean, he's a great actor, but even when he shows up on The Sopranos like years later, you know, he still has, you know, hints of Pauly there with him. But you see in the third movie is really where you get that explosion, where he sort of like lets it out in the opening of the third movie.
Yeah,
where he, like, you know, all his frustrations and jealousy really like come through, and then they kind of work it out.
But it's also in two, I mean, it's kind of an interesting, because now in a way Pauly becomes successful in the second one. Mm-hmm. You know, he's like, well, you need a handout, you need money. You know, he ends up buying the car. He's doing really well with Gazzo.
Yeah.
He's lost weight. And
which, did he do that? I thought I heard a rumor that he didn't really want to come back for the second movie and had lost weight for another part, and then eventually agreed to do it. I don't know if that's true or not, but
yeah, I don't know. Maybe. I can't imagine. I mean, I guess I can imagine that somebody wouldn't want to come back for it, but
hey, it happens. Look at Richard Castellano, Godfather 1 was like, didn't end up in 2. Robert Duvall didn't end up in 3. It, you know, does happen.
Yeah. But, you know, Duvall had a little more going on.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Than Bird Young.
He's only made 6,000 movies.
He's kind of, he is underutilized in terms of a character and what he has to do. But again, I think he delivers it. You know, he comes, he's eating a snow cone and he's thriving as a money collector. But you do also in those scenes where she gets sick, you know, and you do see that he cares for her ultimately, you know, like he's upset when she collapses and then he comes to bring her flowers and he sees that Rocky's in there and he just, you know, for doesn't want to interrupt whatever's going on there, but he's, you know, you do see that he through it all, he does care about his sister. Mm-hmm. And then he goes and, watches the fight with her to help her take care of the baby during the fight and all that.
And the fight, how many face punches happened?
Well, that's
there are so many connected
That's in all of the Rocky movies. The fights, that's part of where you have to sort of again start to separate it from reality. That the choreography and the actual boxing fights themselves. I mean, nobody punches each other in the face that many times in a real boxing match. Like, humans couldn't survive that.
Like Rocky, and as a child, I didn't watch boxing matches, but in a sense, like, so the Rocky movies ruined boxing for me because when I watched a real boxing match, I'm like, this is a nothing. Like they're barely hitting each other, and they're always hugging each other, so they don't get the. You know, they're always grappling so they don't have to take the blows. And I was like, and just watching this again, like so many, Rocky takes so many jabs to the face, like so many. Like
That's his style. That's how he blocks punches.
Yeah.
There was like, no, he doesn't block one goddamn punch.
He does it with his face.
He blocks it. He just blocks it with his face.
And like,
well, but for this is all for dramatic purposes.
No, I'm not saying this is a bad movie because the boxing isn't accurate. Like it's just, you know, it's funny to think of like just the devastation to an actual person if these punches were actually landing would be just out of control.
Well, and that is something to be said though for young viewers coming to the movie. Like, you know, I watch a lot of these movies that we cover with my kids. And they did point that out when we watched Rocky 2 specifically, that they were like, how, like, this doesn't seem like anyone would be hit this many times. It couldn't happen. Like, yeah, it's all for the purposes of the story. So
I've been punched in the face exactly one time and I cried afterwards.
I'm like, sorry. I was after a rough recording.
Well, John, unhappy, like, and I've forgiven you, but tell you, there's still scars.
That's why we have the partition now. But I don't know. Yeah, I totally hear you and see.
I love it. I mean, I love it. I will take it as the world of Rocky. I don't care. Like, but it's really funny. Like, there are just countless blows. Just
and that slow motion, super slow motion ending to the fight. You know, it's just takes forever and I love it because now as an adult I'm like, you know, I love that build up to the moment when it's going to happen. As a kid though, I was just like, oh my god, like do it 10 times faster.
What with when they're both down and getting up?
Yeah. When they're being counted out.
Well, like, and that counting out that is like, for me, Back to the Future, I still don't know if Marty McFly is going to make it back to 1985
right
in the climax. Totally. Because the music, the tension, the action, I still don't know and I am still enthralled, and that's exactly what happened.
I say the same thing about Back to the Future all the time.
How does Rocky you get me.
It's like every time I'm always on the edge of my seat. Is he gonna make it?
Oh my, I don't think he's gonna. I don't know. I'm not sure. He might be stuck in 1955. And that was the same thing with the count out. The way that was edited is like, Rocky's never getting up. Like,
yeah, I love Conti's music in this. There's a lot of recycled music from the first movie throughout the movie, but
that's okay.
Sure. Yeah, because the music's great and it's Rocky, you know.
It's the themes. It's like, it's okay to have those themes and come back to them. But he does it with a different spin in this, in each movie, really.
Yeah, yeah. But this, you know, when it goes to slow motion, you have the music gets all creepy, which it does too in three during the Pauly scene that we were talking about in the beginning of three. But you have like, I don't even know what Horn's doing, but it's like these weird, like whale call.
Yeah. Like wavy kind of sound. Yeah.
And, but it's, I mean, Conti's a genius. When I interviewed Conti, in relation, and we were talking about the first one, I talked about him about the first one more than I did in any of the other ones, but, he told me, and so I can only take with the, from his, from what he says, but he says that they shot and edited the entire fight for the first movie. And it was originally in the movie. And the, one of the executives said, well, what are you doing? The guy's like, just show me the first two rounds and show me the last two rounds.
Yes.
And then just fill it in. Like, you can't sit here for 45 minutes.
Yeah. They did 15. They shot 15 rounds.
That's like, that's what Conti says. It seems absurd.
I would believe it. I would believe it though, with the way that was being choreographed and not knowing what you're going to always use later.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can see it.
Well, I wanted to see as I'm watching this, I'm like, could I take the Teen Wolf montage music Win in the End by Mark somebody, I'm blanking on his name. Could I paste that over the fight and still get the same energy? And, you know, Conti's great, but I feel like I would still really enjoy the fight if it's just Rocky fighting against that Teen Wolf music.
Well, I mean, that's equally as good music. It's would anthemic. Never argue that.
It's such a great song. It's a great tune. I love it.
Or was it You're the Best from Karate Kid? Oh, was that one or two? It was one, right?
It was the first one, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that
yeah.
from Karate Kid, that song?
Yeah. You're the best around.
Yeah, that's some good stuff.
Yeah, God, this... Bill Conti's score, you know, it really is amazing. I mean, just not only just the first movie, obviously the bulk of the material is built for the first movie, but you know, those somber notes, I'm going back to the first one for a second, but those somber notes when he's alone, you know, alone in his apartment, he's looking in the mirror and he's looking at his picture of him as a child, like that's one of my favorite moments, that really just kind of sad, lonely music. Just it's one of the best examples of encapsulating a character in the music that I've ever seen. I mean, it's really hard to do that and do it so well.
Yeah, I mean, Conti, you know, he in a lot of ways never really got his due. I think he was nominated. I can't remember if he won, but he got nominated for The Right Stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't even know. Maybe Gonna Fly Now was nominated for the first movie. I know it was a hit, but it wasn't a hit really because, when they eventually released the soundtrack, it became a hit again, but, somebody like Maynard Ferguson or somebody covered Gonna Fly Now for the when the first movie came out. But yeah, I mean, his music in Rocky.
No, he was not nominated for the first movie, at least.
Sure, he was.
Was he?
Yeah, he was.
Oh,
for Gonna Fly Now. Yep.
But did not win.
For the music and Carol Connors and Ayn Robbins for lyrics. But did not win.
I interviewed the one of the writers. I was going to try to write a book about the first Rocky score, you know, the I forget what publisher puts them out, but there's these 33 and a third books and they're each about an album. Mm-hmm. Very small books about an album, and I pitched a book about the Rocky soundtrack. And I wanted to write a little book about that, so I interviewed one of the lyricists for Gonna Fly Now, but they also wrote music for lyrics for some of the other songs in the movie. But yeah, I mean, it's the same thing. I mean, the reason why, one of the main reasons why I love Karate Kid so much is Conti's score. He's just brilliant and he just understands how to tell a story musically. And I think for me, like I said in the beginning of this, you know, when I hear the Rocky, like I can hear the Rocky music and just cry from it because the it's so linked to that movie and the emotions that get conjured up in me while I listen to it, that the music alone can do that for me. And there's not really a whole lot of other music that can do that for me. Some of Williams' stuff from Star Wars gets me because of that relationship of growing up watching those movies. Mm-hmm. But Conti's just, he's a master storyteller in his own right, and being able to tell the story through music. It's just such a beautiful marriage, and the way he captures not just Rocky as a character or all of them as characters, but the fight and the yearning to go the distance. There's everything about it. And his fight music is always just so great. It just, there's a momentum to it that just works. And we see that if that note existed from an executive to be like, show us the first two rounds and show us the last two rounds, that becomes the template for Rocky fights.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the fights themselves sort of become a montage, right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you start having montages. There's, you know, Rocky IV has two training montages.
Oh my God. And they're all amazing. Every one of them.
They're some of the greatest montage movies of all time.
I was about to say the same thing. Like that really birthed the montage sequence, which is
Eisenstein would be proud.
Yeah. But like Karate Kid and Rocky, all, you know, five movies of Rocky, three Karate Kids, Conti's music is charging you into all of those climactic battles, and it's you're hooked, and it's all in the same, it's all the same, it's all the same.
Yeah. And in the later movies, I mean, they use more of you know, they're not really using Conti's score, especially in the fourth movie.
Vince DiCola does the score for the fourth one,
but they still work in so many ways, you know, even if they're using like 80s music too.
Yeah. But even DiCola's score, which Rocky IV is also a score that I absolutely love and I've come to appreciate even more over the years, you can tell that even though he's not maybe using Conti's music all that much, you do hear some Gonna Fly Now coming in here and there, but you can definitely tell that Conti has set up a template. There's a formula that Conti has established.
Sure.
That whether he's using the actual music or not, he does follow the rules of how the music works, where it comes in, how it works in the montage, how it works in the fight. Like everything's been established by Forrest, so that even though Conti's not there to do it, and I think the man's name is escaping me because it's a hard name. But the guy that does the Creed movies, I think also does a fantastic job of one, capturing the world of Rocky without just doing Conti's music through the majority of the movie. But then even when the Creed movies, when it gets to that point and then Conti's music comes in, it becomes a Rocky movie.
Oh yeah.
And the waterworks fire up.
Yeah.
And it's Conti's music more than anything that gets me in those end fight scenes of the Creed movies.
No matter what happens in this franchise, like I care about Rocky. I care what happens to him. I always get sad looking at the franchise as a whole that, you know, starting with, you know, spoiler alert, everybody, if you haven't seen anything past two, just click it off right now. You know, you lose characters each movie, you whittle away, you know, you lose Mickey, you lose Apollo, you lose Adrian at a certain point.
And in five, you were supposed to lose Rocky.
Yeah.
In five.
But we didn't.
He was going to die. Yeah.
But we, you know, at the end, it's, and then Tony Burton sort of makes it through all the way to Rocky Balboa. And then when we hit Creed, we see that Pauly is gone. And I think they mentioned that Tony Burton's character, which I forgot his name. Is it
Duke? Tony Duke.
I was going to say Drake, but yeah, Duke. He's gone as well. So it's, when you hit Creed, you're left with just Rocky. Rocky is alone again. He's come full circle. He's back in that kind of grungy apartment, you know, or house, whatever. And he spends a lot of time at Adrian's grave, just talking to her. Like those scenes got me so bad.
Yeah. Well, when I remember I saw Creed. I don't know if it was opening day, but it was Thanksgiving Day. I was here in New York by myself. I didn't go anywhere for Thanksgiving. I went to see that, and seeing Rocky, spoiler alert for anybody who hasn't seen Creed yet, seeing Rocky like suffering with cancer was like seeing a member of my family struggling. Yeah. And I like snot coming out of my nose. I was, thank God, like nobody else was at the movie theater.
Yeah.
I was a mess.
I saw it at home with my kids, and I'm like biting on like a blanket. So I'm like, if I stop biting on this, I'm gonna lose it, right?
And at the end, when he's struggling to walk up the steps,
yeah,
it got me. I mean, look, the fact that he was able to bring back Rocky for Rocky Balboa and have it work,
yeah,
was shocking. And the fact that somebody else who was inspired by Rocky II, growing up watching Rocky II with his dad,
mm-hmm.
was able to bring back that character again in a lot of people's minds. When you start talking about Rocky on Twitter, Creed is a lot of people's favorite Rocky movie. I think they're a little younger than we are.
Sure.
You know, they didn't grow up with it. But the fact that so successfully Rocky rode again.
Yeah.
And I'm not as thrilled with, I'm not as into Creed 2 as I was.
Yeah.
First,
I mean, it wasn't as strong. I mean, it's cute. It's cute to tie it in with 4, but, and wrap that storyline up.
The way I think of Creed 2 is if you took all the scripts and all the movies from all the Rocky movies and you loaded them into a computer and you told AI to make another Rocky movie.
That's Creed 2.
Like Creed, it would spit out Creed 2.
I haven't seen Creed 2. I saw Creed, but I didn't see the second one.
It's interesting how much the franchise has changed and kind of circled back around, because, you know, yeah, like we talked about, you've got 1 and 2 who are its own kind of style and they mesh very well together, even though you can see a slight difference when we hit, you know, when we transition into 2. You can tell, like, well, I mean, Paulie's lost weight. It's a little bit of a different film quality. Adrian is, you know, hair, makeup a little different for her. But when we click over to 3, a lot's changed for Stallone, who is securely a major star celebrity. He's made it, you know, he cemented it probably because of Rocky 2 being a success. And then 3 and 4 are much more of your standard Hollywood gung-ho pro-America, you know, kind of movies, and more of action movies, really. Like I said before, there's 3 fights in Rocky 3, and it's one of the shortest running times, I think. And 4, you get 2 big fights, a lot of montages, you know, a lot of, it feels like constantly action, and there's not as many of those soft, quiet moments.
Yeah, he's driving around. You get the No Easy Way Out montage.
Moscow.
You know? You get the 2 Moscow training montages.
Yeah.
But 4 is great, and I just recently, because I watched the director's cut of 4.
Yeah, what do you think? I haven't seen it yet, but I've heard about it. Yeah.
Stallone, over COVID, decided that he was going to go back and recut 4.
No shit. Oh, yeah. I didn't know that.
And it's on, I think you can get it on pay-per-view, or you can rent it right now.
Yeah.
Not pay-per-view, but on demand.
It's 38 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. He has 38 minutes, but takes out like 42 or something like
that. Oh, really? Like he takes out a bunch and adds a bunch?
Yeah. Yeah. He takes out, I don't want to ruin it for you, but he takes out the robot.
Oh,
the robot.
The robot is the heart of the Rocky franchise.
The opening of the movie.
It doesn't work for me, the 4. It's an interesting, someone who loves the series as much as I do and knows almost every frame of each of the movies. Yeah. It's a really interesting watch to see what changes he makes, what footage existed that he didn't put in, that were put into 4. But ultimately, the movie itself, the rhythms are weird to me. And maybe it's just because I'm used to it being a certain way that it just feels weird. you can kind of, it, to me, it feels like a really, it feels like a rough cut. It feels mm-hmm. like you're watching a really clean, fine, rough cut. And, but you're like, yeah, all those cuts made a masterpiece ultimately. Of 80s-ness.
So during the pandemic, he was just like, well, I got nothing else to do. Let me put 10 million really. Into this and add more footage. And
why he didn't do 5, I don't know.
Yeah, there's a lot of, maybe there's too much work to be done with 5.
You know, you could strip out all that 90s, early 90s, you know, hip hop. And
yeah,
but there's, you know, there's the, I don't know if you guys ever seen it, but there is a rough cut that has floated around from time to time online of 5 that
takes the kid out, takes the son out of the movie entirely. Yeah.
Well, it just Tommy Morrison out.
I'm sure you could run Tommy Morrison's performance through some kind of AI and make it a better performance now.
Yeah.
Machine gun.
But yeah, 5's certainly the one that needed it more, I think.
Well, you know, so much changes between 2 and 3, and that Rocky is suddenly like, Rocky's very different in 3. He's extremely wealthy, well off. He doesn't, you know, he speaks, acts, looks like more of a, you know, upper class rich guy, you know, which he is, but like, he just doesn't feel like the same Rocky to me. I like that Rocky too, but he's just a different Rocky. And then, you know, if you parallel 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, they're just very different takes on the same character. And then with 5, you have that abrupt change right back to trying to get back to the original Rocky, you know, down to the wardrobe, the hat, everything. And it's just, it 5 just feels like it's lost its way a bit. And it wasn't really clear how that was going to work.
Yeah. Yeah. It definitely, I mean, you can say, well, you know, what could the logical next step for the Rocky character be? And this seems like a logical, okay, he loses everything.
Yeah.
And he has to go back. He has to, but yeah, it just didn't, ultimately it just didn't work. Although I remember seeing it, and I remember I saw 4 and 5 in the movie theater in Philadelphia. And the audience cheered at the end of 5. I mean, it worked when you were there.
If you lived in Philly, I grew up in Scranton, Pennsylvania. I watched every episode of The Office religiously, and it was a good show, but there were times I did not enjoy The Office, but I watched it because hell yeah, it takes place in Scranton. Like, so same thing, you know, if you're in Philly, like, that Rocky is one of Philly's heroes, you know.
Oh yeah,
he's forever. Right up there with Benjamin Franklin, who like but you know, it about Rocky 5. Ah, damn! I lost the thought, because now I just wanted to talk about how awesome Scranton is.
we'll come back to it if you
remember. Yeah, yeah.
But then, you know, by the time you get to Rocky Balboa, it's like they've righted the ship. You know, they've figured out what. All right, let's get back to basics. Let's think about this. In 2006, where would Rocky be? And it makes so much sense that it's stirred up by ESPN and you know, doing that dream. You're basically a video game dream fight of the current champion versus one of the best of history, which is Rocky, and, like, you know, telling essentially the George Foreman story. So, but it works, and it's, and I love the ending of that, and it feels like a great farewell. Yet we get Creed again, finds a way to bring it back and have it make sense. Like, that storyline makes total sense. That
we're gonna
shift it to Apollo, you know, Apollo's world, with Rocky being a supporting character, but it works.
I think maybe part of what doesn't work about 5 is that it's, in a lot of ways, it's trying to do what 2 did, and it just doesn't do it as well. You know, a guy who's on top, he's been to the pinnacle of his life, and now he's, what happens after he can't fight anymore. Yeah. And, you know, he has to go back and, you know, in this case, he tries to fulfill the Mick role, which doesn't work, but works so well in Creed, you know, it's, in a way, Creed does for Rocky what Rocky V tried to do, but it does it successfully in terms of the character.
It feels like, I don't know, there's something about Five that doesn't feel genuine, where there is so much, you know, there's a genuine quality to all the films before that. Five just feels to me always felt a little bit forced. Like, okay, like we got it. We need another Rocky movie. What are we doing? Let's come up with something. Whereas the others seem to be a little bit more organic.
This seems Rocky V seems a little more clean, right? Like it's kind of well produced. They just overproduced.
Yeah. It's polished a little too.
It's a little much polished. Bigger budget. You know, by that point, you've got four big hits behind you, so you can sort of like do what you want at that point.
And there's something to, I mean, there's something to the attempt of, like, you know, Tommy not responding to Rocky filling the Mickey role, right? Because they're not the same. And but he's trying to, you know, Rocky's trying to force Mickey's lessons on him, and you know, the arrogance of a hotshot guy in the 90s, you know, saying like, this isn't, like, I don't agree with this, and the money and the way, you know, like the Rocky One and Two doesn't really focus too much on the money of it all, you know. It's part of it, but it's not a motivator. Where
it's the lack of money that Rocky One and Two focuses on.
And then, like, but you know, it's about that, like, you know, Rocky loses everything, and now Tommy Gunn could be a big star and make a shitload of money, and with his promoter and blah blah blah. And it's tough because the 90s kind of suck, right? Like, to reflect, like, sort of the attitude of the 90s directly, it's kind of like, ugh, like, ugh, what kind of era are we living in, right? It's less of the, you know, bootstrapping kind of thing, you know, working hard to become something that you know need to, versus like the glitz and glamour of and the celebrity of it all. You know, but that was what's always interesting about Rocky and Apollo. And, you know, Apollo was the champ. You know, Apollo was a big deal and endlessly wealthy, huge ego, big star. And Rocky's just this guy who just gets called up into the majors. And we only get to see it through Rocky's perspective, you know, and that's this, you know, Rocky Five kind of shows it from the inside, and then but losing it. So, and there's just, I don't know, there's just always something gross about someone being extremely wealthy and regardless if they lose it all, or to me,
well, it's more engaging to see Rocky, you know, fighting from underneath and being what he is that underdog. And it's sort of the opposite, you know, by the time, you know, through three and four, it's sort of the opposite. And obviously those movies work in an entirely different way than one and two. I have equal love for those, just in a different way. You know, in my age now, I prefer one, two and Rocky Balboa. Those are my favorites. If that were the trilogy, I think that would be a beautiful, beautiful trilogy right there.
Well, I think, you know, what three does do, though, is, you know, it's all in that scene where he's not training, and Adrian goes to him and she's like, what's going on? And he's like, I'm afraid. She's like, of what? You know, I'm afraid of losing what we got. She's like, what do we have that, you know, who cares? You know, it's about, like, okay, he has something, not just a reputation, but he can provide for her, can provide for his family. He's had wealth for the first time in his life. He doesn't want to go back to living in South Philadelphia. And but Adrian, that's the beauty of that movie, is she's like, who cares? You know, we did it, we can live. And then the juxtaposition of, you know, four, where he goes to her and she's like, why are you doing this? And she's like, you know, and she's like, she doesn't want to lose what they have.
Yeah.
And now she is the powerful part of that scene on the stairs, is it's the exact opposite dynamic of, it's the exact polar opposite of that scene on the beach with her.
Right.
And she's like, you can't win. And he's, to her on the previous movie, he's like, I can't win. And she's like, so what? You know, you're not going to be able to live with yourself if you don't try.
Right.
So it's just, it's still there, but yeah, I mean, it's just that he's wealthy, but yeah, you know, the fear of losing that wealth is what kind of drives some of that story in three. Obviously there's a lot more going on.
Speaking of wealth, should we see how Rocky II did at the box office?
Sure.
Time for a little box office glory. All right. So the budget for Rocky II skyrocketed from the original. We have, it was what, $1 million on the original, and it's $7 million here. Ooh. For Rocky II. So that's an enormous increase.
Yes.
You can stay at the finest hotel in Philadelphia.
You can reduce the grain of the film stock.
How grainy is that first movie?
Oh yeah.
It is sandy.
Part of the magic.
It is rough.
It opened up on June 15th, 1979. I have it as number one. Obviously, box office records are not as easy to sift through prior to the 80s, but it did a $6.3 million opening weekend, ends up with $85 million domestically, $112 worldwide. So that's almost a $200 million gross. So off a $7 million budget, I think that's a pretty enormous hit. It is the number three film of 1979 between the Amityville Horror and Apocalypse Now. So that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Pretty good. I'm surprised. Good run.
And that was also the year of Alien came out that year.
Exactly.
So it did better than Alien.
Yeah. That stupid movie. No, we cover that movie. We love it.
It ends up box office wise, if you compile all the entire films of the franchise, it totals out at number four between Creed 2 and Creed. So sandwich, it's in a Creed sandwich.
It's the creamy center of a Creed sandwich.
It is. That's how you describe Rocky 2.
Rocky 2 is the creamy center of a Creed sandwich.
Oh my God. Yeah. But, you know, that's in the top end of things. So, you know, I think nothing but a success on all levels for Rocky II.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, good for them. Good for Rocky, right? One and two, just a solid 1-2 punch.
Yeah.
I didn't really intend to say it that way, but it's just, you know, it two is a logical extension of that first movie. It's a direct sequel to the day. The fact that the final fight is 10 months after the original fight, in the like where he ends up getting married and having a child in 10 months
and buys a house.
It doesn't
all the
even
things you don't want to do together.
Yeah. And he didn't train for six. Actually, the timeline doesn't exactly make sense, technically speaking, in terms of unless he trained for about 3 days before the fight. you know, it's a fascinating look. It doesn't matter. Who cares?
Well,
but it is 1 year later. So
yeah,
he was hauling meat there for a few weeks.
He did that,
which is a good workout. Yeah. So,
I mean, look, he still stayed pretty jacked. He just wasn't jogging through the neighborhoods.
You know, you brought up the kids, and you think about, you know, 1979. There was nothing wrong with kids just following some guy across a city, you know, leaving their doorsteps, just running out.
Yeah.
You know, I'll be back when I'll be back from dinners.
Yeah.
Miles through Philadelphia.
Miles. Yeah. There's no adults to be seen. Like these children are.
And once
running.
They get there, all those kids got to make their way home.
Yeah.
And he's just like, well, all right. See you guys.
He's not running back.
He's taking a cab.
He's taking a cab. The other kids got to take himself. But I did want to ask a Philly, like a friend from Philly, like, you know, from the opening of the movie, from where the fight happened to, because like he goes to Pennsylvania Hospital. Where does the actual fight of the first movie take place? Is it in Philly as well?
I think it's at the Spectrum in Philly.
Yeah,
it's
also
the Spectrum. So it's the same.
So it's the Spectrum venue. Both times. And I'm just like, is that the actual path an ambulance would take from where the Spectrum was to the hospital? Because I don't think that's true. I can't imagine that.
Yeah,
that sequence of streets is exactly
also where Rocky, if you map out the entire everywhere he runs in the first Rocky, it's something like 36 miles or something like that. He covers in that run.
So he's got
Powerful he is. That's how powerful and strong.
Well, it's a montage. He's not doing it all at the same time. He runs here this day. He runs over there the next day.
Yeah. Stops for a sandwich over here and
stops at Pat's for a cheese steak.
He leaps off the Liberty Bell. Like he just runs and just jumps off it.
A parkour move goes off
the, goes to the Franklin Institute to check out the.
But when he gets to the top of that museum steps, and then the it's as good as the first one. It's better.
Well, and that's the thing with this. Awesome. You get that happy ending that you kind of got with the first movie. It's happy from a personal perspective, but here he does it, and he does win, and he gets it all. He's got everything now. And so could end the franchise, but no.
Yeah, but and it goes to show that it's like sometimes it comes down to just that one thing. Like that the ending of Rocky II could have gone either way, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not like he just decimated Apollo. Like they were that they was it really could have been a coin flip.
That's how
good Rocky is, right? He is as good as the champ, and it went his way.
And when you get the "Yo, Adrian, I did it," like that line is just as famous as anything from the first movie, you know. And I think people kind of forget that that's actually Rocky II. And a lot of the running montage that you see, obviously with the kids, being from this one, I think that's an assumption from some people that that's also part of one.
Yeah,
but.
Right. No, that makes sense. I will say though, his final, like, I got to say something and talks on the mic. It's kind of a snooze, right? It doesn't.
No.
That finale. I don't know. I think you need to put as much as like Rocky is not a very, you know, articulate kind of person. He needed a little something more meatier to say there. I
think that said it all.
It's like, aside from the birth of my kid, like, this is the greatest day. I was like, what about your wife who married you? And I don't know. And he didn't. And like, he just said, and he does the "Yo, Adrian," like it's like a callback more so than like he should have said, "I love you." You know, I don't know. That's what I thought. I thought his speech at the end was a little weak, not great, but fine.
I'll disagree with you there.
Oh, come on. Blake, what do you think? Is that the best speech Rocky could have given?
I totally understand what you're saying, but I think the speech that he gives is so perfectly Rocky.
It's very Rocky, yeah.
Anything more than that might have not worked, and that it just would have not felt right.
Yeah.
The thing that works. One of the many things that works so brilliantly about both of these movies, the first two movies, is that it's just the dialogue, you know, and I don't know how much of it is just improvisation between him and Burgess Meredith, and just there's these little throwaway lines, and sometimes you can't even really hear them when he, you know, he's like, "Oh, it's Apollo," and he's like, "Well, who'd you think it was going to be?" He's like, "I was hoping he wasn't going to show up," or and when Apollo comes over and he's, you know, he's giving it to him, and Mickey's like, "You know, don't let it bother you, kid," and he's like, "Well, would it bother you?" He's like, "Yeah," you know, Mickey says, "Yeah. And it's just so it's simple, but it's so authentic. And I think that's part of what you were saying, you know, in terms of why five doesn't work so much. It's like that one does kind of seem forced, whereas Rocky one and two, you know, they almost, I said it about Burt Young, but you could almost say it about all of them. Like they seem like they just captured, X amount of months in these people's lives, and then just there was cameras on them at that moment.
Yeah.
It just works so well. Mickey, you know what, you got that space monster. He's like, "Would you come here, kid, to show me your dog?" And he's always, you know, and Burgess is always, and Mickey's always making, you know, it's like in the Bible they say this, and everything's biblical with him in the second movie, he keeps on saying, and it's absurd, but you don't question it for a second, and you only really notice it when you've seen it 30 times.
Yeah.
You know, you start to realize like that, what a weird line.
Yeah.
You know, or a weird trait that he has. It's just, it's so authentic, and the heart, and especially the first two movies, is so big that it's, it, you look, they're, it, it's the reason why we're talking about them. And it's the reason why your Rocky episode, you know, still gets people to download it. Mm-hmm. It, they touched something in all of us. It's universal. We all, everybody knows what it's like to, you know, we're all Rocky. You know, I said, you know, that all the characters in the first movie are Rocky. He just happens to get the chance, but we all are. We, there's all something that we didn't fulfill yet or may never fulfill. We all had dreams. We all got to a point. We're all, you know, even if you're not, even if you're young now, you will at one point get to a point in your life where, you know, you have just something to strive for, and we all want to get that chance. But there's also the part of us that I think also understands that most of us would be afraid to take that chance if we mm-hmm. got it.
Yeah.
And Rocky fulfills that for us. And you see it in the first movie. When the promoter says, "Why do you want, you know, get to fight for the heavyweight championship?" The last shot of that scene when he's talking to the promoter in the first movie, Stallone looks at the cat, looks directly at the lens, and the look on his face is like, "Holy shit, what am I going to do?" Like, I can't do this.
Yeah,
right. And we never really see his fear until he is yelling at Mickey, and he's like, "You want to come? You want to see me get my face kicked in?" And then we see a little bit of that in that mm-hmm. beautiful scene between him and Adrian just before the night before the fight. But that's what works in the movie. It's what we relate to it because we're all Rocky. We all want that chance, but we love watching it because Rocky's not afraid to take the chance, even though most of us would be.
Right. Yeah. I think you just nailed it. I mean, the fact that, I think it touches something in everybody. I haven't met anybody who's seen Rocky, honestly, who maybe it's not their favorite movie, but who hasn't, you know, really been touched by it and you know, to some extent connected with him and his journey and look at the franchise to this day. It's still going, you know, that I don't know how long it's going to continue, but it's sort of been reborn with Rocky's still a part of it. I don't know what his involvement is going to be going forward with Creed. We'll have to see, or what other Rocky related things are going to come up. But yeah. It's an interesting franchise to look at, and I'm sure we're going to, you know, at some point next year, we'll probably have you come back here and take a deep dive into specifically Rocky III.
So you guys, I was curious as to why you guys decided to do two. Is it just because you're going in chronological order?
Yeah. I like to do these things chronologically and tell like the story of the franchise as well. For like, we're doing it for Halloween, Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th. You know, we just click the next one in the series, and because I'm interested in them as a the movies themselves, but the scope of it in general as well. So we'll see. So three is on the docket for some point later next year.
Unless we get to Oscar first. So
hey, yeah, we'll do other Stallone things too.
Yeah, Stallone's coming back.
Oh yeah,
before Rocky III, we gotta get stop from my mom will shoot.
Well,
did we do Cobra? Did we do Cobra yet?
No. Oh, believe me,
Cobra's gonna be definitely on the docket. Episode.
Cobra's one of my all-time favorites.
Yes, it is.
We did do Tango and Cash though. Almost That's forgot true. That one. But,
classic.
Yeah. So, you know, we talked about a lot about Bill Conti and the importance of the score here. That's your wheelhouse. So tell everybody again one more time where they can find the Scored to Death books and the podcast and where they can catch up with you.
Well, the two Scored to Death books are available on Amazon for other book retailers for me directly at scoredtodeath.com. They're basically a collection of, in both books, a total of 30 interviews with film music composers who have made significant contributions to the horror genre, spanning from, you know, the composer of the Dark Shadows television series through all the great horror franchises of the 70s and 80s up to you know, disaster piece who did It Follows, and you know, some Japanese composers who perform Audition and The Ring and whatnot. And Score to Death Radio, you can hear from the Cinematic Sound Radio Network. And that's basically a music show, not an interview show. But if you haven't heard the episodes of interviews from Score to Death, the podcast, which is a different podcast, you can go check that out. You know, anywhere podcasts are available. You know, that show, for the most part, especially the early episodes, is still kind of horror centric. But, you know, obviously Bill Conti, I did a follow up interview up to the Bill Conti episode because Bill Conti did do one horror movie called Nomads, directed by John McTiernan, his first was that, feature.
Was Pierce Brosnan in that?
Pierce Brosnan.
There we go.
Nice.
But Conti did that score, and someone who collaborated kind of on that score and plays guitar on that score is Ted Nugent.
Mm. Oh, wow.
So I did a follow-up interview with the Nuge.
With the Nuge.
about Nomads after talking to Bill Conti. And like I said, at some point, I'm going to have a David Shire, very interesting and lengthy interview with David Shire about his career on such, Taken, Pelham 1-2-3, All the President's Men.
Yeah.
So many great scores that he's composed.
I can't wait to hear that. That's going to be amazing.
Zodiac.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We'll talk about that. So.
Nice. Well, good. That's exciting. So we're looking forward to that. We'll make sure we tell everybody once that's ready. Here on this show. So we're gonna say just a quick shout out and thank you to some of our other friends, EK Wimmer for the theme music. You can check out his podcast Laser Graves, that's very 80s centric specifically. And thank you to our friend Curtis Moore for the poster as usual. And Blake, thank you again so much for coming on this week. Thanks, it's this is your second time here, and we're just loving having you here, and especially talking about Rocky.
I appreciate it. Rocky is one of my favorite topics, and I always feel bad that I feel like I might have hogged the mic a little too much when I leave. But now that I don't have any other outlets with Saturday movie sleepovers, it builds up in me until somebody unleashes it.
I like your insights, and it encouraged me to throw mine out there as well. And it's a lot of fun to just talk all sorts of. There's so many things you could. We could do a whole podcast series on the Rocky films, right? Like,
oh yeah,
so there's so much to say. Like, so we're you know, we're just like scratching the surface on the things that really resonate, and so it's really great to get your perspective, especially where you're coming from. You know, just starting from the score, but into the actual analysis of the film, and it's just wonderful. So,
thank you.
You're always a second time out. It's like. Great, Blake's in another park again. Like, this is great. So glad you
appreciate it.
He's got an office here at Recon Cinema Studios.
Of course, now. He's got a parking space. He's got a valet.
73rd floor, right. Absolutely. There, right. Yeah. There in the corner.
It's all yours.
All right. Well, again, everybody, check out Scored to Death, and if you haven't seen it in a while, check out Rocky 2 again. And we want to wish everybody a happy and healthy and safe New Year. We will see you guys for our next episode. We've got another special lineup coming in January, so we'll see you in 2022.
Bye now.